as I was thinking about this, and you know, I've followed all of our panelists really closely, and as I think about sort of the economies of this work, of writing and responding to culture as a professional, whatever professional means, or as an artist engaging that conversation, it strikes me that cash might not be the central question, but compensation might be. And that could be professional compensation, that could be intellectual compensation, a sense of collaboration that Carolina was talking about. But I think, even with that, I think we have to start with the question of pay for writers, before we get into publishing models. And I really can't think of a better way to start than Yasmin Nair's essay, Scabs, Academics and Others Who Write for Free. This little nugget is really striking. The system of free writing has created a caste system, she says, with those who can afford to work for free doing so, while those who can't struggle to pay the bills and often give up. As with unpaid interns, those who can afford to write for nothing inevitably make it into networks of influence, which allow them to continue on to actual paying gigs. She goes on, if you write for free, you are making it possible for publishers to refuse to pay professional writers what they're worth. You're contributing to what she calls the adjunctification of writing. Her solutions are really blunt. If you're any kind of writer, demand pay and good pay, even and especially because you don't need it to survive. If you're a would-be publisher who wants to provide a space for radical feminist whatever writing but don't know how to do it without your pay rate starting in the hundreds and not the measly tens, don't publish. It's as simple as that. So my first question for our panelists is, how would you respond to that? Do you think people who can't pay should just not publish?
Well, I think what that essay does, I have some problems with that essay. I don't like to write for free, and I think writers should get paid for their work, but it completely, there's no nuance in who or what a writer is. People write for a lot of reasons. People write to as part of another process. If they're an investigator doing research, the written result is a sort of an ancillary part of their research work, or for an academic to publish findings. So there's a lot of reasons people write, and I think to kind of put this blanket statement, like if you're writing for free, then, you know, you're a scab. Like, I don't know, there's something really ooga booga about it. It's right. Like, and I also feel like, you know, writing is a form of communication. It's one of the oldest, you know, after talking, it's one of the oldest forms of communication. And people haven't always gotten paid to do it, because sometimes what you're expressing, you know, is not necessarily drawing an audience or a paying audience or things like that. So I think that essay lacks a lot of nuance.
I have a problem with it too. With when we started, we started paying very little. I mean, what we could afford. I mean, both me and Hudag had full-time jobs for the first 2 years to pay writers, but we knew we needed to start somewhere so that we could start paying writers and increase it over time and really grow. Because starting from zero, or growing from zero, is probably impossible. But growing from $20 to $40 to $50 to $75 to $100 seems like something that we could all build together as a community. So our writers as a community, our sponsors and our publishers, and us building it together to get to this point. So I disagree that we shouldn't start, because we need to start something. And that's what we're trying to do.
I have mixed feelings about it as well. I mean, I think the human in me wants to agree with the idea that, you know, we should, as writers, you know, should be demanding pay for our work, and that writers and the work we do should absolutely be valued the same way that the work that doctors do, or, you know, anybody else does, is valued and you know, certainly monetized. On the other hand, as the editor of a website and as a book editor in the past, you know, and somebody who is lucky enough to be able to pay their writers, I really liked your point about the different, you know, and it's not something I think about very often, but the different models that paying your writers can take. And this idea of barter is a very good one. I know we spoke a little bit at dinner last night about the sort of back and forth that a writer can have with a really good and involved editor, and mm-hmm. the work that an editor puts in, you know, to improving a writer's writing and thinking process, hugely valuable. And that's something I've had with my own editors at Freeze and Art Forum and on books. So I recognize that that is one mm-hmm. characteristic of payment, or at least compensation. You know, on the other hand, we, many art writers, live in cities like London and San Francisco and Los Angeles and New York, and pay, cash pay is utterly important. It's vital, literally. So yeah, I mean, you know, the idealist in me wants to side with her, you know, but the realist in me, you know, understands that demanding some kind of compensation, whether that is intellectual or cash, is utterly important, necessary. And yeah. I'm really glad you made that point. It wasn't something I'd really thought about, though we had touched on it, and you just made it a very strong, you know.
I'm used to asking
convincing
for stuff.
I mean, I think one thing, that quote, it sort of assumes a top-down industry. It assumes this existing infrastructure that is able to pay, and I think it's something we've talked a lot about in this of, there are a lot of predatory publications out there, I think, that they kind of subsist in their infrastructure and they pay some people and not others, which came up in several different panels. And I think the thing that we were reacting to is, if you set out that model, then a lot of things are not talked about. So if you do separate this conversation from industry to a field, what are you doing? What is the work? You know, something that we considered starting in a place like St. Louis, but also in a lot of cities, is it just wouldn't happen. You know, if you set out these kind of ways, a formalized structure, then what we're going to see is the art critic from the newspaper gets fired, and then you go 5 years and there's nothing, you know, and that's kind of not good for anyone. It's not good for artists. It's not good for writers in those areas. And so you really have to consider, like, what can you make happen otherwise? Sometimes, you know, that can exist in a paid writing position. Sometimes it can be a nonprofit publication, whatever. But I think that there are always other approaches, I think, to make sure that it's happening.
James, when you guys founded Temporary, who were you serving? Who are you writing for? Who are you accountable to?
I mean, I think we were accountable to ourselves. We go back to the beginning. It was really an artist-run space. I mean, we think about that in terms of spaces or galleries, but not really about publications. But it's increasingly common that it was sort of artists. And I mean, I also run a space that had exhibitions that would just not get covered. And so there was kind of an accountability to ourselves that we sort of looked around St. Louis, but also we started out immediately kind of a national conversation. And the idea was that we wanted to talk about artist-run spaces, alternative spaces, projects that were ephemeral and were likely just not going to be covered, and so there was no archive around it. So we felt accountable to a way of working, I think, and actually documenting it, taking it seriously, being critical about it as well, so not just kind of boosting that way of working, but actually what is criticism that is more directed and intentional. You know, underlying value was, we felt like that was a really important moment in time. Kind of this, we started in 2011, but really from 2009 on, you started to see this sort of resurgence of the artist-run space. And I think that we just felt like that conversation wasn't happening, and that we weren't really willing to wait for it to happen either, that at a certain point, you have to take responsibility for it yourself.
Right. Thinking about conflict of interest, because I know Vikan spoke really well, I think, to the idea that from the very beginning, if you're approaching especially arts writing as journalism, you're thinking about who you're accountable to and how you can keep the editorial, you know, church and state, how you keep them separate so that the source of your funding doesn't unduly affect the kinds of stories you feel free to tell. And I'm wondering, Carolina and Eugenia, you've worked as freelancers, and you know, this creative entrepreneur model, this go-it-alone freelancer who's kind of a hired gun for a lot of different publications. Are you finding yourself in, when you're in that role, you have to create your own kind of ethical superstructure for determining your own sort of comfort level with conflicts of interest, or is that still dictated by the publisher that you're writing for? Because to me, those lines feel a lot more fluid with these sort of artist-driven and freelance-driven enterprises.
I mean, it depends on who you work for. I did a lot of public radio work, and public radio has, and especially NPR in Washington, not necessarily local affiliates, has very strong conflict of interest rules. And when you sign on to be a freelancer, even though you're not staff, you're still governed by conflict of interest rules. So it means I couldn't make any money from any person I might be in the position of covering in the future. And so it meant I couldn't really do catalog essays for galleries. I couldn't do projects for museums. I couldn't do any of those things. And sort of that governed the ethics I obviously applied to all of my work. And it governs what I do at the LA Times right now. We have very strict, you know, like Christopher, I can't get paid to be here. You know, like very strict rules.
I mostly freelance edit books for publishers and museums and galleries, and that's, you know, the primary source of my freelance work. So, you know, I think there are self-imposed, you know, an ethos that you are driven by, and that's kind of how I operate. There really aren't conflict of interest issues, except if, you know, in the case when I was working at Freeze, you know, if I was, you know, working on, you know, I wouldn't be working on the book of someone I'm writing about in the magazine, or somebody I'd commissioned someone to, you know, write an article about, you know, an artist or a designer or a musician or something. I wouldn't be working for that person in another capacity. But I think that doesn't feel very fluid to me. I mean, that feels quite, you know, obvious, frankly. So, but, you know, as far as book editing goes, I think, you know, you don't have quite the same commercial or advertising interests that, you know, would bring those questions up. So in my case, I feel a little bit free from that, thankfully.
Are there self-determined lines that you're drawing, or is that express? Is that made explicit when you sign on to a project?
Oh, no, definitely self-imposed. Absolutely self-imposed. And publishers are of a questionable ethos, I guess. In some respects. So, no, definitely self-imposed. You know, there are, you know, kinds of books I won't do, or, you know, certain, you know, topics that I won't edit on because it's not an area of expertise. You know, I'm not going to edit a book on neuroscience, you know, like, it's just, yeah, they're self-imposed. They're common sense, quite frankly, you know.
What about you, James? How do you avoid artists? If part of this is filling a gap, a sort of documentation gap, and we're going to do this for ourselves to provide a kind of critical discourse that's missing outside in these in-between cultural zones that don't have the kind of publishing maybe they used to, how do you avoid people playing fast and loose with the barter system?
I mean, I think that's something that we have to be aware of as editors, of people sort of wanting, you know, if you want to cover what you're doing, then this is maybe an opportunity that you'd see. I mean, I think we've experimented with different ways. One thing that we've been doing more recently is kind of throwing that question out the window of conflict of interest. We started doing, for kind of longer duration, I guess publishing, we have been doing these things we call social responses. And it actually starts with the curator or institution organizer stating what they intended to see happen. And so it goes from there, and it's basically bringing that into the body of the review and making it explicit. So I think that's one way, is making it really clear who the person is that's writing, who the critic is, what their connections to all these things are. But I mean, it's something that isn't really for us. I mean, conflict of interest isn't really a financial question. I think that that's come up a lot in other conversations of, you know, are you beholden to your advertisers? You know, and that is a whole other conversation that's really problematic. And I think for us, it's sort of our duty is to make sure that something is documented and talked about, and then we self-select. We don't write about art fairs. We don't write about commercial galleries for the most part, even museums. So there's kind of a self-selecting thing. People have to enter that conversation and be willing to risk relationship. I think that's the thing that we find is Everyone in these fields are very tied together, and you just have to kind of embody that. And, you know, I think people have a hard time doing that, but it's kind of coaxing it out, and the editorial process helps with it as well. Mm-hmm.
Right. That's certainly something I've run into. We have a lot of artists in our stable of contributors, and I think it's been trickier than maybe they would have anticipated, much less we would have anticipated, for them to switch gears and wear a critic's hat. And what does it mean to do criticism as an artist who's working within a practice, mm-hmm. you know, giving critical feedback to your peers? And does that criticism look like, you know, criticism that's published by a newspaper or by a magazine or by Hyperallergic? It seems to me like maybe they need different terms because they're kind of not functioning in the same way.
Are there? Do you set them out?
I don't really set them out, but I find that we're publishing fewer straight reviews because I'm really interested in foregrounding artists who are, like, foregrounding the voices of artists who are working with from within a practice. I've found, almost by happenstance, really, that some of the most interesting critical analysis, if you get away from the consumer guide model of reviews, mm-hmm. right? So the most interesting actual sort of analysis is coming from people who really understand and have a deep investment in the practice. And so I wouldn't want to discount that. But I think there's then this push-pull, because that's a different kind of critique. And it kind of functions differently. It's really deeply interpersonal. And, you know, it has come up where people are writing about folks that they know well. And it's troublesome, I think. Beacon, you've spoken well to the idea that you specifically don't sell advertisers on the idea
right.
that they're supporting the writing.
Right.
Could you articulate, how are you making that case? Are you selling them on the reader?
Yes. So we approach them and try to sell the access to the audience. So we engage our audience. We can educate or inform our audience about something that needs to be addressed. So we address their marketing goals and not their PR goals. So we don't think about how this campaign will influence the writing. It's completely separate. And I think that we've been able to grow the audience big enough, and through the network have reached into many different audiences together, that we can really provide value there for advertisers, where they keep coming back and buying bigger and bigger campaigns to reach our audience, and it has nothing to do with the editorial. And we have 500 sponsors versus 10 big sponsors. So if we lose one, you know, it's not a big deal. So we can keep going. And we work with a lot of nonprofits and art institutions and art schools that we don't necessarily write about anyway.
Right.
And their mission or their goals align with ours of reaching and growing the audience for art. And so they're not looking to influence editorial. The ones that are usually call me, ask for a review. I say I can't help them, and then they hang up. Or if they put a review, buy an ad hoping for some kind of editorial, don't get it, they don't come back. So we've weeded out all that, and we really focused on the ones that really want to reach our audience first.
Okay, but I want to, you guys are doing really well now. Jillian just got an award. You've got a lot of traffic. You have 500 sponsors. What did you do years 1, 2, and 3 when you didn't have that kind of clout and when you couldn't make the case? Like, were you just doing the hustle?
Yeah, we over-delivered, under-promised and over-delivered on everything. So if we took a campaign, we charged less than it was worth and delivered twice as much value. And really that just built a reputation over time, word spread. People kept coming back for more, and we just kept building from there. So I think it was daily execution, you know, very hard work. It took years to build, very slow going, but it just built brick by brick. And about the third year of Hyperallergic and Nectar Ads is when we really started to get real momentum. And we were able to quit our jobs and start really building it. And then word started to spread and campaigns started coming in, and, you know, it was really exciting, and we just kept running and keep building it. But, you know, the first 2 years is very slow going, kind of just patience and lots of hard work. But always providing value. Like, really, we had to think about, like, the ads are not just tacked on and with no thought. I had to really think about the ads and what that experience was for the readers as well as the sponsors.
How did you articulate that to the people who were providing you with the ads? Like, how did you lean on them to get beautiful, worthwhile?
So, you know, I had to do a lot of extra work with them.
Did you make it for them?
Sometimes. We did a lot of free consulting. So I did a lot of teaching. I had to teach them about the world of online advertising, how they should approach campaigns. You know, it wasn't just picking up the phone and selling inventory for this price or that price. So I had to really bring them on board. And I think that made the difference. So if someone called me and said, I've heard about blogs, I want to advertise, but I don't know what to do, I'd spend an hour with them talking to them about what are the opportunities, what they can do, and how they can best accomplish their goals. And I think that's really how we started.
So you're sort of educating your advertisers and bringing them into the
Well, think about it. In 2009, there was no real art ad marketplace where people were buying online ads. It was really a new thing.
When did you reach the threshold? Like, how did you determine internally when you'd reached a threshold that it was time to bump pay for writers? Did you have an internal formula?
No, just as soon as we can afford it. We haven't really, this is the first year we might make a profit, but every time we made more revenue, we would just increase our writers because we know we're not paying enough. We know we're not where we need to be. So, but we wanted to start and not start from zero. So we started, but we keep bumping it up slowly over time as we can afford it. And we're committed to keep that going.
I'm thinking again about sort of the transaction of compensation and of value. And the sort of declaration in that check that you get when you've written something for a publication that says, this means something to me, this is valuable, this is work that we're going to treat right. Given the interpersonal kind of intangible qualities of that relationship, that transaction that you're making, do you find that as writer, Carolina, when you have written, you know, under a number of different sort of contractual terms, sometimes collaborative, sometimes free, sometimes paid really well. Do you find that your investment in the editorial process for any given piece, like how is that connected to the way you feel valued?
To the way I feel
valued? Or the way that you're being compensated.
Do I feel more valued if I'm getting paid more? Is that the question?
Well, okay, so in digital media, if you think about sort of the way publishing works, I hit publish, but that's not the end. That's the beginning of a reader response and a sort of ongoing conversation and long tail click through. And ideally, as an editor, I would really love for my contributors to be thinking about that article as a living thing, especially if there's reader conversation happening around it. But it feels like a hell of a lot to ask a contributor that's getting $150 for 1,000 words to moderate the conversation around it. And so I'm wondering, like, what do you think is reasonable to expect on the part of editors and publishers to expect that sense of stake and ownership in the publisher? Like, where does that sense of shared ownership come from?
That's a tricky one because I think it is something, especially when you are really busy doing a lot of stories, the onus of sort of maintaining sort of a social media presence after a particular story has run. You know, there is an expectation that you're going to do that as a writer these days. I tend to have the point of view of, like, I treat my stories equally regardless of where they are published. I feel like a story, no matter what story I do, it has my name on it, and that hopefully that name means something. So just because a site paid me $100 to write the piece instead of $1,000 doesn't mean I'm then going to be like, oh, see you later, guys. You know, I'm not going to, you know, I'm too busy to tweet it or engage in a discussion about it or whatever. I mean, I see all the work I do as just being part of this larger ecosystem of things I'm interested in. So whether it's a well-paid magazine or a tiny blog, I'm going to treat it the same.
Eugenia, did you notice that the investment from your contributors changed as you were able to go from free to paid?
That's not what changed, actually. No, I mean, this is a slightly different conversation to have, but, really the investment that, I mean, you know, our writers, our regular writers and even those who are only once a month or once every couple of months, you know, I think most of our writers work really hard, and I appreciate that. And all of us at Design Observer put a lot of work back into them, maybe me as the editor especially. And And I think that that, you know, that makes those pieces more valuable and potentially it gives them a longer lifespan out in the world. There was a time at Design Observer until about four years ago, where the comments section was incredibly lively and was as much a part of the post as the post itself. I mean, you know, 60 comment long threads that were full conversations, you know, between the writer, often Michael or Bill, you know, would get in on the conversation as well. And, you know, we had a number of regular readers who kind of commented on everything. And those were, I mean, those were kind of great days, you know, that they...
Does anybody have good comment sections anymore? Well, or has it all moved to Twitter and Facebook?
Yeah, well, that's what happened with us, unfortunately. And that, you know, as soon as, like, you know, the on switch on Twitter went on, that entire thing moved over there. And you know, if there is a tragedy when it comes to comments, you know, the tragedy is that it's no longer a discussion. You know, it's moved to Twitter, and it's now just, you know, that's great, you know, or retweet. Or, you know, there's no, you know, no one is saying anything of substance on Twitter about anything. And
a lot of people live tweeting right now.
We welcome your questions.
That is getting retweeted so hard right now.
But
hashtag Superscript 50. Yeah.
But and put that dot in front of the at book endless so all of my readers see it. You know, for Design Observer, it has actually been a big blow. You know, we really, we valued that. And in fact, you know, we're doing these books now, and the first two are coming out this summer, and they are essay collections from the site. And that span, you know, quite a long period of time on the site. And there are posts that we're reprinting, that we're re-editing and reprinting, that had, you know, really rich discussions in the comments section, and we've decided to reprint those as they appeared on the site because, they, as I said, you know, they were as much a part of the discussion as the original posts were. And that's, you know, if there's one way we can, you know, resurrect that or, you know, try to stoke that a little bit more, that's one way. Another way is that we have encouraged our contributing editors and our contributing writers, you know. You know, we don't ask much of them usually, but we do hope they're reading the site every day, and you know, and we want them, you know, to at least comment. We don't need them to, you know, go into some big long philosophical discussion about every post. But if they could, if something does touch them, you know, or move them, you know, if they could just comment, you know, that really helps. And I think a lot of our readers, you know, would love to see Michael and Rick and Jessica back in the comment section, and you know, and our other contributors. But, you know, it's a momentum issue, and we just, you know, we should try to start that up again because, you know, the Facebook and Twitter just aren't really compensating for the loss of that. So.
Has the making a public objective worked for temporary? I mean, you guys have pretty good comments.
Yeah, I mean, I think it has because I think it spans both audience and contributors that there's a sense of there's a stake in the conversation. And I think it's not a site that is aiming for this kind of mass circulation. So I think that if you're there, then you want to have the conversation, which I think does drive, you know, more interesting comments. Like I appreciate when people kind of take the time to do it there where it's searchable and also connected to the original source. And I think that helps. You know, there have been definitely cases where people write responses off the site to that as well. But I mean, I think that we have kind of intentionally, I mean, we were running a book club for a while that was built around comments. The entire discussion was in the comment section, ours included. So there was just sort of a general introduction. And then it was really intentional, like, can you do that? Can we return? I mean, I think that there are only a few sites doing it well. I think it's actually rebuilding a culture around that kind of thing, which I know, like, Eflux Conversations is trying to do as well. And it's really like, you know, the thing about, you know, Facebook and Twitter, and the thing is, it's not really archived. It's there, it exists, but it's not really searchable. It's not returning the value back to the original conversation. And so ultimately, like, a really intense thing can happen and then it doesn't return back to a community, mm-hmm. actually, that it benefits, however you define that community, unless it's just your friend circle, because that's all it's reaching. So I mean, I think that we intentionally do invest in that. I mean, have a sense of our stake is the same as our audience, is the same as our contributors. And I think that that sort of holistic ecosystem is what we're after, really. And so in that way, I think it's succeeding.
Your editorial staff is volunteer too, right?
It is, yeah. I mean, I am fortunate. I'm full-time as the executive director of a nonprofit, but temporary exists entirely outside of those hours. You know, it's kind of extra to that. So yeah, I mean, we have started paying, I mean, again, so we just started paying writers if they choose recently, started paying, our other editor is kind of like doing copy and managing the site, and she gets paid a little bit for that, but it's kind of comparable to the scale of the writers. Mm-hmm. So there's no sort of extra infrastructure layer of like, where does the money go in administration and all of these things? It's really transparent. And I mean, in that way, it works like a cooperative. It's just a really kind of decentered, sprawling cooperative. But
how do you handle decision making? I mean, my experience with publishing started with print, and that's got such a top down kind of dictatorial power structure. Like, the, you know, my editors would decide how much we could afford to pay, a publisher would decide, and the editors would decide who to assign, and that's shifting online to the good, I think. But those, the power dynamic of both money and editorial mm-hmm. control, moderating conversations in the comments, like who pulls the plug? In an overtly sort of collective environment, what if you brought in a writer who didn't necessarily immediately fit into that public and was kind of an interloping voice? Can you envision a situation where you were, would there would be such discomfort that you think we're going to pull the plug on that person, or that's not our kind of piece and we're not going to put, like, how do you, as a collective entity, how do you make those decisions? And
yeah, I mean, it's not decentered in that sense. Like, it is edited by two people, you know, and we make the decisions about those kinds of questions, including moderating comments and things like that, but also choosing what we publish and what we won't. It's not kind of a free-for-all, and the decisions in that sense are not. It's kind of, and I mean, intentionally don't talk about ourselves as a collective. Like, it's not collectively owned and anything like that. It's really about transparently sharing what we do have. And I think that, but that doesn't give up editorial control at the same time. And I mean, I think that's the thing that's been kind of the question of, you know, a lot of it for a few years, it was kind of what people would send, or we would seek out and specifically ask for certain pieces from people that we knew. And it was kind of a broad thing. As it's become more and more popular, and those things are, you know, people just send us stuff, we have to be a lot more careful, mm-hmm. I think, with our editorial process.
We got a good brass tacks question here from Katie Hill. She wants each of you guys to talk actual numbers. Is it always a dollar a word? Does anybody make a dollar a word anymore, for real? Writing about the arts?
Not online.
No. I haven't for years.
Well, I'm staff now, so right. I have this magical thing that happens where every 2 weeks this money materializes in my account. I can go to a doctor too, that's pretty, without having to go to Mexico. As a freelancer, the pay rate was all over the place depending on that outlet I was working for. I did have dollar a word assignments and $1.50 a word assignments. Occasionally, when I was working for some highfalutin travel magazine, I could even get two, which is magical. Oftentimes it might be a flat rate. So many of the art magazines would be like, okay, an 1,800 to 2,500 word feature, but we're paying, you know, $1,700, and that's, mm-hmm. you know. But I always tried to negotiate something that was sort of in the range. Like, I needed to be, a dollar a word does not assure a comfortable living, it assures a living. Right. It's like, I'm not talking about, you know, vacations in Cancun. I'm talking about, I can pay my rent, I can pay my bills, and maybe I've got some money left over for happy hour PBRs. Like,
I don't know anybody who starts at a dollar a word.
No.
I don't think you spring fully formed like out of Zeus's thigh getting a dollar a word.
And then, you know, I have done work for free, and I've done work for $50 and $60 and $100 and $300, because sometimes you negotiate. You know, like I said, it was sort of putting that checklist through my head of like, you know, is this worth it for me? Am I really passionate about the topic? Am I subsidizing some place that doesn't really need subsidizing? Like, if the questions amount stacked well for me, I really feel this is a personal decision, so it's not necessarily a template. You know, yeah, I'd do a 500 word piece for $50. Like, I wasn't, but I needed the dollar pieces to survive. I was also on contract for WNYC for a bit as an on-air critic, and so that was also the steady stream of revenue that I had as
for
a writer.
For freelance work, I sure don't know of anything like an industry standard.
Yeah.
It's all over.
The web writing. Yeah, it used to be the dollar to $2 a word, but web writing, I mean, web writing made
but
it completely, yeah, web writing turned it into here's $25. And yeah, and like I said, if it was sort of like a small scrappy outfit doing something interesting, I don't have, you know, who's trying, like, okay, we're going to grow this together.
Right.
But you know, when the Daily Beast is approaching you and they're like, we want a 2000 word reported feature in 3 days and here's $200. I'm just kind of like, you know, tell Tina Brown to take a cut on her lunch expenses and pay me a living wage, you know, like, no.
Right. No, thank you, Huffington.
Yeah, thank you. Bye.
Well, similar to Carolina, as a freelance editor, I kind of had these thresholds, you know, or when I was working for, you know, if I was doing a book or, you know, exhibition copy or something for a nonprofit artist space, like I had one rate that was way below, you know, the rate I would charge if I were, you know, copy editing a 500-page catalog for the Met or somebody else of that size. If I was working for a commercial publisher, there was another rate. Though working for a commercial publisher, it's usually just a big flat lump sum. You know, like Isaac's, I don't know if Isaac is in the room still, but, you know, like his tattoo, you know, of, you know, don't read the comments. Mine would be never amortize, you know, like you can never, you know, never think about that, you know, because those jobs, you know, those editing jobs that some editor or publisher, you know, promises are going to be 3-month gigs and they become 7, you know, because the main essay doesn't come in for months, you know, that's, you know, there's that part of your life, you know, like you'll never get back. Speaking as the editor of Design Observer, we have a 2-tiered rate system for what we consider short pieces and then long pieces.
What's a short piece?
A short piece is anything up to about 400 words.
Okay. What's the rate? We got a specific
question
here.
That's fine. I'm happy to say.
Jamie Millard says, okay, what's the rate?
Our rate at Design Observer for a 400-word piece or an up to 400-word piece is about $125. And anything in the 500 to 800-word range, or longer for that matter, we, you know, sort of depends on how much longer pieces become. Sometimes we serialize pieces, is $250.
I mean, I also used to negotiate a rate sometimes like, oh, our website pays 40. I'm like, great, pay me 50. Because it's like, you're going to get clean copy from me. It's going to be well reported. Like, there's also certain things, like when you've been doing it long, I just feel like there's a certain something you can bring to the table and just be like, great, you're just going to pay me a little bit more than you pay everyone else. Like,
well, I think that's fair.
It's going to hurt just a little.
I mean,
Carolina's going to take that bar and lift it with his shoulder.
I mean, similarly to this, you know, it took me a really, really long time to start saying no to jobs that didn't pay enough. And I think as a freelancer, you are just so, you know,
terrified.
You're terrified. You know, you think you say no, you know, to some gallery, and you know, the no in your brain, your neurotic brain, my neurotic brain, is that, oh, they're never going to call me back, you know, which is complete, you know, it's completely asinine. That's not true. If they value your work and you don't, you know, I was talking to somebody about this who said, well, you know, and who was trying to point out how ridiculous my thinking was, you know, she said, but you as an editor who commissions writers, you know, if you went to somebody you really wanted to write, you know, a piece and they said, you know what, I'm writing an essay for a book, I don't have time to do this right now. And she said, would you never go back to that person because they didn't have time this week to write you a post? And of course, the answer is no. So,
it got to be at that level to be able to have that kind of negotiation.
Freedom, perhaps. Yes, I mean, but you know, I guess the same woman I was talking to, who's also an editor, or she's a book editor, said to me, you know, I've been editing books for many years, and you know, she told me very point blank. She said, "Act your age. You know, like, you're at a point now where you don't have to take, you know, like, you know, the $300 gig to edit a gallery guide, but you have a Rolodex full of good young editors and writers who would be great at that and would, you know, kill for that opportunity, you know, to work for a big commercial gallery on something." And she was absolutely right. And, you know, it seems to me, you know, it finally dawned on me. It was just like, right, well, this is the point in my career as an editor and as a freelance editor where I should be kind of beginning to nurture people. And, you know, it's the next generation of editors, whether they're freelance or otherwise, that I should be helping out and giving that work to. So that's one way of looking at it.
James Bridle asks a question finish the numbers. Oh yeah, but you barter mostly.
Yeah, I mean, so mostly we allocate ad space, but if writers, guest editors choose, then our rate is generally 50 to 150. I mean, that's...
Yeah, we have different tiers depending on the type of writing it is. So something like an investigative piece that takes a little longer, some research might get maybe 100, 150, something that's a blog post, 500 mm-hmm. words. We usually start at 50, and we're hoping to be raising that in the fall to 75, but that's pretty much where we are. And we, since we're not paying dollar a word, or we're generally working with younger writers who need opportunities, we publish 12 posts a day, so we have a lot of opportunity to publish lots mm-hmm. of new voices, and our editors work really hard with them, so we're nurturing kind of a new
crop.
Generation mm-hmm. of writers and working with young writers, and I think that's part of the value that we can provide now while we can't afford to pay the full rates that we'd love to pay. So we try and compensate in different ways as well.
Well, along those lines of value and like who values this work is what James Bridle asks, which is a great question, and who should be paid like doctors and who pays doctors and do you want to be paid by a system like that? But I would add an addendum, like, whose work gets valued like that? And that seems to me a really critical question about access and actual diversity in arts writing and who can afford to go through these sort of really low levels of unpaid or barely paid work mm-hmm. to reach the point where you can command a seat at a negotiating table to say, like, I'd like 50 instead of 40. And like how can we as editors and publishers, how can we open the door a bit wider? And like, what are the economies of that for a young writer?
I mean, I think writing has always been, magazine writing has always been problematic for that reason. When you're starting out, you're not going to make very much money. I mean, when I started out, my first job was an intern at The Nation, which was a full-time job, Monday through Friday, 10 to 6, and I got paid $75 a week living in New York City, which meant I did moonlighting at a bakery. I stuff cannoli like nobody's business. Like, unbelievable. So I didn't come from a family that could support me while I figured out my, you know, like I was not the cast of Girls. Like I had to make a living, so I worked at night. You know, slinging coffee and cannolis and it gets really frustrating and exhausting and you're sleep deprived and, you know, you don't have the advantages that another more affluent person might have. I mean, it's a real concern. And also, you know, coming from, it's not like I come from a family, like I ran into a lot of people in New York. It was like, you know, their uncle was so-and-so at Time Magazine and their, you know, I didn't have that, like... My parents are immigrants from South America. I grew up in Southern California. Like, this was not their world or mine until I entered it. But what I do think the internet has done in terms of diversity is that it has, you know, it's allowed voices like mine. You know, would I have been hired by a major daily under the old system? you know, to do what I do now? Probably not. I don't have a degree in art history. You know, I don't have some of the paperwork that it takes to get those jobs. But I think through the work I did online and through doing things like my blog, I was able to prove that, you know, you don't necessarily need that, that, you know, you can be a good writer and a good reporter and do your homework without the piece of paper. So I think the web there has provided an outlet for different voices and also allowed voices like myself to build an audience, because, you know, in a print publication, sometimes they'll be like, oh, Latin America stories, nobody cares about those. Or, and it's like, no, I know people who care, and on the web, you can publish them and kind of show that there is an audience for it.
And to a certain extent, I think building that audience means writing the stories as an article of faith that the audience will come if it's a good story.
Yeah.
Do you find that with the more global sort of arts coverage that you've been doing? I mean, you're unusual among the Brooklyn-based outlets for being really intentional about having national and international.
Yeah, it's something really interesting for us, and we really want to highlight diverse art scenes in different parts of the world. And I think people now come to us to learn about that and to read about different things going on. And I think we've developed that audience.
Yeah. Let's do that. Stephen Sugarman, and then you in the back, I see you.
Just talking about the...
Could you hold on? Think, as Ori would say, think of the internet. Oh, yes. Let's be mindful of people listening remotely.
Well,
hold on. There's a mic coming. It's heading at you. Other way.
Thank you. My question is, are pay rates the same for writers here as they, and say, for example, in Europe? Are European writers paid more for doing arts writing? Do you know?
In Europe, or if we commission European
writers? No, I mean
writers.
In Europe. I'm talking about in Europe.
I have no idea.
Here's
really the basis for my question. Are writers outside the U.S. paid differently? Because the public has maybe better educated, more interest in the arts?
Not for the web. I don't think so. I mean, my little experience with that and other editors I know doing this kind of work abroad, no, I think the pay is paltry there as it is here.
Universally paltry.
Yeah,
I think in most parts of the world, being an arts journalist is, you know, it's a vow of poverty. Yeah.
Like. It's a vow of poverty. Okay. All right. Okay, cleared that up. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, if there was a country where I could get rich doing it.
I know.
We'd all be there right now.
Yeah, we'll totally go. There's a question up there. She's got her hand up.
Hi, thanks. This is a great conversation. I'm so glad for the transparency of it. The publication I founded titled Momus, I forgot to mention that at the earlier session.
I love Momus.
Oh, thank you. I'm paying $200 per piece right now. That's where I started, and I'm about to bump up to $300. I'm sort of disappointed to hear the rates that I'm hearing. I'd like to think my rates are sustainable. We'll see. I guess my question is this. With, say, Hyperallergic, why not publish less and pay more? Is the only way that you can maintain the relationships that you've built and the traffic that you've built at the pace that you're publishing?
I mean, that's kind of our thinking, that we really wanted to grow the audience and we really wanted to capitalize on the momentum to create a sustainable foundation and then build from there. We felt like if we just published once a day or twice a day, that we wouldn't get the critical mass and momentum behind us to really build a business, and then it would just peter out and kind of die after a few years. So I think that's kind of how we approached it. And really, our goal is to raise those rates, and our goal is to build something long-term, and we always had a 10-year plan. It wasn't 2 years, and we'll figure out what happens. So we really, the first 5 years was about building this momentum, and then going forward, we're going to be building the business around it and building up all the infrastructure that supports it.
You in the back, and is there another one after? Anybody over here have one? Yeah. Sorry, Nick, you'll be next to you and then. Yeah, there's someone up here.
Yeah, we're going to ask
you first. Sure.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Hey. Oh, shit. I work for an LGBT pretty much like alt weekly in my region. While I'm a young reporter interested in going national, a number of my colleagues aren't. They really do want to have the opportunity to tell these stories in our community. But we all have clearly have different, more specific forms of ad revenue than y'all clearly do. Do y'all have any experience, and I guess maybe Carolina may the most, with like, how will we survive? How can we tell these rich stories too? I mean, granted, I work for an LGBT weekly and we just write about how people want to beat us up every week, but you know, that comes with the territory. I'm not guilting y'all, calm down. Like, where is the role of community journalism in this in the end? Not citizen journalism, but places like ours. Thanks.
Well, I'm a little confused as to what the question is. Is it how do you make a community journalism story a national story? Is that?
Well, we will localize like a lot of stories.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Oh, hey, thanks. Yeah, I mean, again, I'm seeing this as a lot of national conversation, but
yes.
What is a way that could be relevant to bring this discussion to alt weeklies, regional magazines?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Oh, got it. I mean, it's really interesting that you asked that question, because now that I've been at the LA Times for a year, I'm in this really interesting position where I do think about national, but I have to think about local. I'm the LA Times. I can't just be writing stories about the New York art world or what's going on in Basel. Like, that's not my purpose to be there. It's to tell the stories of Los Angeles. And I really think that if there is a place that is really vibrant in journalism, it is in community journalism, because you are there, because you can do the face-to-face reporting, because you can go out, you know, not just be behind your desk talking to some expert on the phone. Like, you can be out on the scene in ways that some national reporter doing it as a phoner just isn't going to be. And I always think of it as every story I do, as it having the potential to be both local and national. That when you're doing a profile of an artist, that when you're telling their story, you're telling a story, and if you tell a good story, it's going to attract readers regardless of where they are. I mean, how many times have you clicked on some viral story in Facebook about some guy in Alabama saving his cat, or some guy in, you know, New York doing whatever? Like, there's a real power in storytelling, and I think the sort of untold power of community journalism is being able to be there. And so it's getting out. It's not just being behind the desk. It's not just doing the phoners. It's meeting people and making sure that your stories reflect, you know, your sort of profound knowledge of having been in the place.
There's a local outlet. Is Alan Burks in here? Yeah. There's Alan. So Minnesota Playlist does the best. There's Alan, founder of Minnesota Playlist. He's a playwright. He and his wife, Leah Cooper, another playwright, founded Minnesota Playlist. They do the most innovative, interesting, critically sort of meaty theater and performance criticism you'll find. And it's for profit, and they're making a go of it because they've enlisted the community of actors and performers who have a stake in seeing coverage like that. But they're not, much like Beacon, they're not drawing them in specifically on the back of that content. Mm-hmm. They're offering them a service. They're offering them, you know, a place to put their headshots and audition announcements and the sort of advantage of having this high-level critical conversation. But to me, like, the huge success that they've had in other platforms like them is actually enlisting their community members as stakeholders, whether that's regional or a community of interest, because I think Hyperallergic has been great about galvanizing a community of interest around.
And we've, I think, figured out how to create a model that works for in visual art, specifically in New York and LA. And now I'm really going to spend the next couple of years trying to figure out how to revert that and make a model that might work for local community journalism or community publications where sponsors are interested in reaching those communities. Right now, those communities are interested in reaching and learning about what's going on in New York and LA, and sponsors are interested in reaching those people. But I want to figure out how to flip it and see if we can get sponsors interested in reaching audiences in local communities around the country, around the world, and how can that be supported, or if it can be. I don't know.
I mean, I think for me, this is like, that kind of question gets to the heart at our model and why ads don't really work and why we never started there, because it was in some ways starting from that all opposite place mm-hmm. of starting in small communities. So in a sense, like, our entire model was we would be working in a community that we would ask what's important to your community, and that's what we would cover, and they would kind of, there would be a back and forth and exchange there. But I think that we actually underplay the value of small communities. Like, advertisers are looking for a mass market, but a lot of the most meaningful work, there might be five people in the room, and I'm not interested in an art world that is kind of catering to this mass audience that kind of an advertiser is going to look for, you know. And I think that there's kind of at the heart of that a really problematic model of, you know, it's why museums commercialize, it's why, like, you know, galleries are looking for this sort of populist thing. It all gets to this question of, like, well, what community do we value, and can we value a small one, and can our model accommodate that? And I think that's really important. It's why that certain things move to be monolithic, you know, in that process.
There was somebody over here. Oh, yes, you. Can we get a mic down for her?
Thank you. I'm going to stand up so you can see me, because I realize it's hard to deal with disembodied voices. My question is maybe a little bit of a curveball, but it goes to that word community that you were just talking about. My name is Bean. I am an art critic. I'm also the editor-in-chief of Daily Serving. Wearing both of those hats, I totally agree with all of what we've been talking about. Paying writers is really important. But I'm also an artist, and so if you want to talk about not getting paid, buy me a drink, and let's go. And so my question is, as people who are communicators and people who have outlets for our voices, what do you think is our responsibility, perhaps an ethical, even a moral responsibility, to talk about the fact that artists are also not getting paid? Because it seems like we have parallel tracks. We're talking about writers not getting paid, and artists are talking on their own track about artists not getting paid. And I wonder where you feel that overlaps or not, and if we have a sense of, like, community and solidarity.
Who wants to take that?
I mean, I would say initially, yes. And that's like one of the main kind of tracks I've been thinking about, is we sometimes think of publishing and arts publishing as the separate sphere. And, you know, I really do think that it works together. You know, it is about the work that artists are making and the galleries taking risks on them, and then us as writers and publishers working with that and responding to it, but taking it all seriously. And I think that there is a sense of solidarity. I think that I think that it's building structures that work, because obviously they aren't there. You know, if we keep talking about this, there's more money in the art world than ever, and it's not going to artists and it's not going to art writers, well, like, then there's something wrong with that picture, I think. And our approach, at least, has always been sort of look around, who is there, who's with us, who's complaining about that fact, and then start there, because, you know, working inside the system to date has not gotten us very far, I think.
Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of the reason, you know, a lot of writers will agree to work below rate or for free is because they view their writing practice in much the same way you might view your practice as a visual artist. You know, there's, you know, it's what you do, and you can't not do it, and you're willing to do it at whatever level, or, you know, at whatever, you know, whatever the stake is. So yeah, I think there's, you know, definite solidarity there, in the same way that writers should be valued. I don't think we really answered James's question fully about value and the value of writers, but the same way that writers, great novelists down to art criticism, you know, is a contribution to culture and society, as, you know, artists are, you know, equally so. And yes, there is, you know, a necessary value that is not recognized by the status quo. And we just, you know, gotta find that. I mean, you know, I don't know, we're not really answering questions here. You know, we're just still talking about it. But
I guess coming from a news background, it's like, you know, sort of looking at the angle of like how I have been following the debate about, you know, for example, a writer, a living artist, getting paid to help out produce like a survey or retrospective for a museum. Because, you know, you hear the story about like the artist in the museum installing his big show and he's the only one who's not getting paid. Like the curator's getting paid, the museum marketing department is getting paid, like everyone's getting paid for their time except for the writer, you know, sort of under the idea, except for the artist, excuse me, under the idea, well, like, well, this show will give them exposure, but, you know, is that artist time there valuable? So that is a story I've been kind of following it, like in terms of covering it. I mean, I also work for a general audience that's not necessarily an art audience, so it's like I always need... For stories like that, I need a little bit of a news hook to write about them. I'm interested in writing about them. But like, for example, there's been this whole case going through the courts about, in California, there's a law that, a resale law that when a work of art gets resold in California, like an artist gets a cut of that resale. That law is now up for question. I forget where it is, but it might be shot down. As a result, also a lot of people sell their art in other states so that they can cut the artist out of it. And it has been this debate about like, you know, should artists benefit from like, you know, huge auctions of their work? That provides me an angle for discussing something like that, or if a group of artists get together and say, no, we're not going to work with this museum until we get paid, that gives me, but it's like I always need like that little, given the platform I write for, I need kind of something to, I need news, essentially, that it's harder for me in the position I currently have to just sort of write the big picture pieces about like, should artists get paid, you know, like, it's a great question, but my platform doesn't necessarily lend itself to it. But I do follow it, and I agree. Yeah, there is that. I especially think of it in the museum setting where artists will, you know, devote weeks of their time to installing a show. And, you know, if they're not a commercial artist, they're not going to reap any benefit from it whatsoever. And in the meantime, they're sacrificing pay.
I know when I'm an artist, we see a lot of calls for donations of artwork come down the transom.
Yeah.
People having a silent auction and the like. Yeah, you had a question. We have a mic come down.
Hi, back to the pay issue. I'm wondering if getting paid by the word is an outmoded way of looking at things, because Christopher Knight said one of the things the internet does is open up space. You don't have to worry about column width and all that. And yet, isn't it interesting that art writing online is short? You know, like, I'm a big fan of hyperallergic, and your columns are short and tight and to the point. So how can a writer make any money if what we're asked to do online is, you know, condensed down?
We actually prefer, I think you can talk to Hadag about this, but he actually, our editorial team prefers shorter pieces that are more accessible. And I think sometimes that's harder and takes longer to write than longer pieces.
Exactly.
Especially for reviews. And so we actually prefer that writers work on shorter pieces, and I think we work with them to really hone them and focus them a little more. And I think
that, and I appreciate that. So that's why the,
but we don't pay
by
the word.
Word.
Yeah, we don't pay by
the word. Doesn't really
no.
apply.
Yeah. I mean, it's one way. Like, there has been the flat rate method that can sometimes work. That can sometimes work pretty well, especially if somebody wants a short piece, but that, for example, requires an intensive amount of reporting. Mm-hmm. So they want the 600-word piece, but boy, I'm going to have to work the phones for it. Then a flat rate makes more sense. So yeah, it's not a perfect. It's by, like, I don't think we have figured out. Yeah, a perfect system for how to bill. And I've done, for example, like photo essay driven things where like I'll choose a bunch of artists, we have them photographed, and then what I'm writing are just essentially very large captions. And so in those kinds of cases, again, like it'll be, I'll negotiate a flat rate ahead of time because obviously the amount of work I put into it is not reflected in the word count.
Okay. Thank you. I just wanted to bring it up.
I could put on my editor's hat for a second, and the whole by the word or even flat fee, if I'm being really candid with you, it's more nuanced than that, because not every word is worth the same to me. Because
there are a lot of factors that go into that from the editorial side. It's not that it's not valuable, but if I have to spend a tremendous amount of time cleaning up copy that isn't ready to go or close to ready to go, that costs me something. That word is worth a bit less to me than somebody who is super yeah. dependable, turns in really well. If I'm going to have to fact check everything because there are sloppy details, that costs me something as an editor. And so I guess if I had a tip to give, it would be sort of to echo what Carolina said, write about a number of things, cultivate a sort of diverse number of subjects, some of which maybe pay better than others that you're comfortable writing about. And even if you can't always get paid what you'd like to get paid to write about the thing that you love, like cultivate your expertise in that and make your copy really clean. Check your facts, link your text, make it easy for your editors, have nice pictures. Yeah. You know, think about the medium for which you're writing, and I'm going to be way more inclined to bump your pay by 10 exactly. or 20 bucks if I know, like, you're going to give me a really well-developed piece that's ready to go that I know is going to be engaging and get me traffic. So it kind of cuts both ways. It's still, like, the bar is still too low, I think, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I've worked as an editor. That's why I felt comfortable. You know, it's like turning stuff in on time. Let's start there.
Huge.
You know, like, just turn it in on time. We don't understand here. Like, so I felt like, oh, I always turn in my stuff on time, and it's generally relatively clean. I kind of felt after working as an editor for a summer, I was like, oh, I can ask for a little bit more money. Like, this is okay.
I think we have time for like one more question.
I think this gentleman right here.
Oh yeah, yeah, Nick.
Great.
Oh,
hair.
You've been holding that. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks. It's a question that's specifically for James. And I love your anti-profit model, and that you're trying to do something else. You're trying to do something different. And I suppose that it's a romantic notion in a way. How do you look forward to? I mean, you're bringing in people, sort of people that you know, people you want to share that information with, but long term, what's your sustainable model? I sort of feel like if you didn't feel like doing it anymore, and you and your partner, it would just dissolve. And if I was someone who was contributing to that heavily, I would feel sort of betrayed in a sense. So I mean, it's great on the one hand. How do you look forward with that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an interesting question, because it is completely kind of in the editor's hands of that sustainability question. I think that ultimately we are attempting to build an alternative, you know, and you talk about sort of alternative spaces, and they do ebb and flow, but some last. I think that we're interested in the question of, you know, we've set it up to be basically profit agnostic is a way to think of it. You know, we do bring in money at this point. We do start sell ads, we do get some grants, things like that, that can bring in a question of sustainability within finance. I think the important thing for us is that as we return to it, that money will never dictate the model. And I think that's the difference. And I think that in that, living in a community and working with an art world that is so saturated with profitability and kind of money changing the terms essentially of what is possible, that I think that there's always a community that's willing to keep that going. And I think that if it succeeds, something that I always go back to, it's about a broader field and a broader way of working succeeding. And I think that you know, that's how I talk about it in terms of temporary, is if we last, then that's one example. But if a kind of way of working takes hold, then that's an entire different conversation, and that's something I'd be proud of, and I think that sort of extends much beyond the kind of site itself. We've already seen a lot of sites start in response to what we're doing, not exactly the same model, but I think that, you know, we work with a lot of smaller publishers. Like, you know, there was a recent kind of partnership we had, and they had like 30 Twitter followers or something, and it was like, but what they were doing was amazing, and I think that it needed an audience. But the fact is, it works both ways, that I don't think that like we're the kind of the model, the example, and if people contribute to our model, that means they're invested in the idea of it. And the site itself is just an example of that, I think.
Do you think sustainability is really always necessarily like, is that really, should that be the top objective in our minds? Is it enough to survive, or should we embrace the idea that some publishing projects will have a natural lifespan and they'll rise, and maybe they will involve pay and maybe they won't, but they're a durational project and they'll go away? Like maybe
absolutely
the sort of self-fulfilling thing. I think we get stuck in the idea of like, it's got to live.
Yeah.
We've got to make it survive.
I think that's why everybody becomes a nonprofit. You know, they become sort of like, if you start to bring in that term, you just think that, well, you necessarily have to go down a certain path that is, it is sustainable. It is kind of a broader community is responsible for it or something. So.
And the internet in particular seems antithetical sometimes to the idea of the sort of indefinite project. Yeah. It really seems to like things that have a lifespan and can rise and go away. Do you guys have any questions for each other? Is there anything we didn't cover? A lot, yeah. Optimism. I don't think anybody up here is saying the sky is falling. I mean, that's kind of what I love about
I wouldn't do anything else. I wouldn't do anything else.
Thanks.
The best.